Today I will be upgrading my builds to a new CPU, the AMD Ryzen 9 3950X 16 core CPU and an AIO water cooler to go along with it. First, start by opening the side panel and unplugging all the cables from the PC. Next up, I will be opening the CPU and AIO packaging. I like how the CPU packaging shows the nice and polished heat spreader. The CPU boasts 16 cores and 32 threads, at a base clock of 3.5 GHz base clock and 4.7 GHz maximum boost clock. Inside the box we have, of course, the Ryzen 9 CPU and a case badge. There's also a warning message that I can safely disregard because I know my BIOS is up to date. Next up, there is the NZXT Kraken X62 Liquid AIO CPU cooler, which is wrapped up in plastic for some reason. Inside there is a manual that you are absolutely going to need if you have never installed an AIO cooler before, like me. Two of NZXT's own radiator fans, cables for powering and controlling the fans, and a USB header for software control. And then there is the black plate for Intel and the AMD retention bracket, plus all the screws and nuts that you are going to need. And then of course the pump and the radiator itself. Note that the CPU block has thermal paste pre-applied. Using this paste is fine for the average Joe, so I will be using this pre-applied thermal paste. First off, I will disconnect the CPU fan cable from the motherboard, then unscrew the AMD Freight Stealth CPU cooler from the motherboard that's on top of my Ryzen 7 1700 right now. Before you do this, you need to make sure the back of the case is also open so you can catch the backplate from falling. I forgot to do this, so do as I say, not as I do. The same applies here. You should really stop and think for a second. If the CPU cooler is not coming off, it is better to not apply excessive force. You could end up breaking or bending the pins of the CPU. I should have first turned off my system to let the paste heat up. Fortunately, I sold the CPU and the new owner was able to verify that the CPU works just fine after bending back the pins. Now raise the second retention arm upwards to the unlocked position and find the triangle on top of your CPU. On this CPU, the triangle is very small but still visible. Inspect the area of the CPU socket and find the small triangle on one of the corners. Line the triangles up with each other and slowly lower the CPU into the AM4 socket, like so. You can wiggle the CPU a bit to ensure that it is properly installed. Now lower the socket retention arm downwards to a locked position. Let's move on to installing the AIO. You will first see my first end experience in this video in locating a position for the radiator without compromising too many features inside my case, which was not an easy task. This is the thumb nut that is needed to screw in the CPU block slash pump. Do not tighten the thumb screw all the way to make mounting it easier later on. Now remove the plastic cover from the CPU block, detach the Intel retention bracket, not shown in this video, and then attach the AMD retention bracket. Now screw in the stock AMD mounting clips to the motherboard and the backplate that were detached previously if applicable. For this, use the screws and brackets that came with the motherboard. Make sure to hold the backplate behind the motherboard in place while screwing them in to ensure proper installation. Now you can see that I am reorienting the AMD retention bracket on the block to make sure the CPU block is mounted in the correct position. Align your bracket with the stock AMD mounting clips and install the cooler by slipping the screw clip loops over the retention hoop. Tighten the thumb screw until the cooler is secure. Do not, and I stress, do not over tighten the thumb screw. Doing so might damage the retention hoops or the CPU. Nice. Here I am unpacking the rest of the hardware for installing the radiator and the fans. Note that what now follows is a bit of voice of discovery on my part, because I didn't think beforehand where I was going to put the radiator. Top of the case might seem obvious, but I would have to sacrifice the back exhaust fan and the optical drive bay, which I didn't realize until I installed the radiator. I eventually decided on installing it in the front of the case, as you will find later on in this video. Now while test fitting the radiator with the fans, I noticed that the radiator wouldn't fit, so I decided the optical drive bay and optical disk drive itself had to go. Which ended up not making much of a difference, because the exhaust fan was still interfering, so off the fan goes. At this moment I was just going to install the radiator and decide later if I wanted to keep it that way. Notice that I am installing the radiator in pool configuration, that is with the fans pulling air away from it to make for easier cleaning. In this configuration you only use the 30mm fan screws and washers for mounting. Now, to plug in the fans to the included fan power cable and attach the SATA power cable from the cable splitter to an available one from your power supply. Then route and connect the large connector from power cable to the CPU block and connect a 3-pin connector on the power cable set to the 4-pin CPU fan connector on the motherboard. Then connect this mini USB cable from the pump to an available USB 2.0 internal header on the motherboard. As you can see, I tried to fit the back exhaust fan onto the case again with no luck. Not satisfied by the compromises I would have to make with this setup, I removed the radiator from the top of the case and instead opted for installing it in the front. Because of this, the hard drive case had to go. It was only housing one SSD anyway that I could easily relocate to somewhere else. To install the radiator at the front of the case, the original fractal design case fans had to be removed to make room for the radiator and its fans. I also removed the front door to allow for easier access. While we're at it, we could do some cleaning.
You know, blow a can of dust at it.
Now orient the radiator with the tube sticking out of the top. I was trying to get the fans installed in the front of the case. This ended up not working, as the 30mm fan screws didn't go fully through the fan case and radiator. So I instead opted for a pull configuration where the fans pull air through the radiator. This allowed me to install the fans first using the 30mm fan screws and then use the 5mm screws and washers to mount the radiator to the case.
Smoke test!
Let's turn on the PSU and then press the power button, and this should pose right about now. Okay, CPU is detected, AMD Ryzen 9 3950X core at 3.5 GHz. All seems fine. I have to note that it's best to reset the BIOS to its default settings to ensure that the correct settings for this CPU are applied. This part of the video was shot 3 weeks after the build, and I have made some slight improvements to it. As you can see, I've installed a fan at the bottom as an intake. This is a fan from an old iBird 212 EVO CPU cooler. I have attached this fan directly to the motherboard. I've also ghetto mounted my 2TB SATA SSD behind the motherboard tray. Well, not the most elegant solution, this works fine. I've also zip tied the tubing to the optical drive gauge to make it not sag onto the GPU. And yes, that optical drive is not connected because it was malfunctioning, sadly. Now let's turn it on. In the BIOS, I've made some slight adjustments. I have, for example, disabled Precision Boost Overdrive in its entirety, because this motherboard's VRAM simply couldn't handle this feature. And I've also applied a mild but stable overclock to my RAM kit. I used the Ryzen DRAM calculator to find the voltages and timings that I could use. I used this program and I sent it at, I believe, 3200 megatransfers per second, and then dialed in those voltages and timings, but then set the RAM at 3066 MHz speed for improved stability. These are the settings I dialed in. You can pause the video for a more detailed look on this. You can see, because of this, the clock speed of the Infinity Fabric is also higher because it's tied to the RAM speed, where the RAM speed operates at under 3600 MHz. Now when booting into Windows, I recommend everyone to install the chipset drivers straight from AMD's website first for the highest stability. For the NZXT Kraken, there's the NZXT Cam software, which allows you to set a custom fan and radiator profile. And custom settings for the lighting on the CPU block. Which look pretty sick if you ask me. Well, that was it for today's video. Hope you enjoyed it and learned something from it. If you had any questions, please leave them in the comment section below.